Hello, everybody, and welcome to the VMware lecture and Labsit demo. Initially, I was thinking of creating two discrete videos, one going through the Labsit and explaining all the theory and everything, and a second one, which would be the demo of actually doing the work for the Labsit. However, when I was going through it, I decided that without me actually showing you what's happening on the computer, explaining the theory and the Labsit wasn't really possible. So there's no point in doing this twice. So I will be creating one detailed, thorough video that I do everything and I explain everything on the Labsit as well at the same time. So the first Labsit for this unit is dealing with VMware. VMware is one of the oldest hypervisors around, or virtualization technologies around, really. And so we're going to be dealing with it. The easiest way to get into the VMware world is to look at VMware Workstation Player, because it's free and you can download it anywhere and install it quite easily, and it's quite straightforward to use. Anyway, the university has an agreement with VMware, so if you go to the link in the introduction, you will be able to basically download most of the programs that VMware has to offer for free. So it's a great opportunity for you to try and explore this in your free time. So you can install everything and see how everything works and try to find some online tutorials and so that you get involved with other technologies of the same manufacturer. So in order for us to do this Labsit, we need to be working inside the Prometheus home virtual machine. Now, you will either have this because you've downloaded it off Moodle and it's running on a virtual machine on your computer, so just like it is on my computer. I always run it full screen so that I don't have to dedicate any more graphics and any more resources to my Windows machine. So I recommend you do the same as well. Or if you're working remotely in the lab, you'll need to connect to the lab, start up VMware, power up Prometheus Home, and then make that full screen in there and work on that. And of course, if you are working at home in a dual boot scenario, this doesn't really apply. Your dual boot, the operating system, will be CentOS. Hopefully you will have built it according to how Prometheus is built, and you can basically use that as it is. So how do we go about using VMware Player here? The first thing you need to do is you need to go and download VMware Player from their website. So if you simply click on the link, you get to this page. Make sure that it's version 16, and you can download VMware Workstation Player for Linux. You click download now, and it will start downloading. It's 160 megabytes. Everything that you download goes into your downloads folder. So here you have your home directory, and this will basically have your downloads folder, and VMware Player is here. So if you want to install it, you basically need the terminal. The easiest way to get a terminal running in this location is to right click, open in terminal, and then you can come on, let's move this down. Oh, my mouse is playing up. Okay, so we can move this out of the way. So if we type ls, we'll see that it's there. It's not executable, so it's not green. So if we go back into the Labsit, we don't need this anymore. Go back into the VMware Labsit in Moodle. Let me zoom in a little bit to make it easier to read. So we are in the installation section. Scroll down. The command to install it is /VMware Player. However, we might need to change the permissions of it, and we do, because if we do /VM, it doesn't autocomplete. So pressing tab on the keyboard should autocomplete unique entries, and it doesn't. So it means we don't have permissions to do this. So we'll need chmod 777, capital V, capital M, press the tab button. It will autocomplete the unique entry and enter. If we type ls now, it's green. So it means that it's executable. So we can /V, capital M, tab, and go. So the VMware installer will start. It will go through the process of installing everything. It's a bundle, so it will configure itself for the operating system that you're installing it on, and it will run. The installation will take a while, depending on your computer speed as well. Just don't forget, this is running inside the virtual machine, so it will inherently be a bit slower. I have decided not to scroll through, if I can avoid it, things that are happening, so that you know roughly how long it lasts. So if your computer takes a while to do something, then you know that it's not wrong, it's just standard behavior, it is. That's what it does. All right, so now installation was successful, so that's a good sign. What we need to do is we need to open a terminal and start VM Player to start the program. Before we do that, we are now going to be building a virtual machine. So we need to go to CentOS and download the ISO for the operating system. So we need to get this one, which is the DVD2009.iso image. So that will, of course, start downloading in the same location in the downloads folder. And we can go back and it will go back into the Lapsed itself. Yeah. So what we're doing now is we're downloading an ISO image that we will use it because we will mount it on the virtual machine so that we follow the installation steps for the operating system. So while it's downloading, I will do the initial steps of the VMware Player installation. So if I type VM Player in the terminal, or if I go to Applications, System Tools, VMware Player, the program starts from there. So this is the initial setup of the program. You need to accept the terms of the license agreement, of course. Accept this as well, click Next. You don't really need to check for product updates on startup, so I would say no, that will save you some annoying messages that pop up every once in a while. And then you don't need to take part in the VMware Customer Experience Improvement Program, so you can just click Finish there. Okay, so this is what the interface for VMware Workstation Player looks like. So you have the home directory, you will get a listing of all of the virtual machines that you will build in here, and you have the option to create a new virtual machine, open a virtual machine, or upgrade to VMware Workstation Pro. And of course you have the help section for the program as well. VMware as a program itself, it has the file menu here, which gives you the same options, and it has the virtual machine menu that shows you a specific virtual machine's settings, removable devices, power, and so on. So once you have installed the virtual machine and it's running, or once you have installed it and you've selected it here in the library, this menu will come alive and you can actually choose items from here. So because now I need the file that's being downloaded to actually be here, I will skip ahead on this. Okay, so the download is almost finished. So we're at this stage. We've started VM Player, and now we will create a new virtual machine. So if we move the VMware Player, we can see that the CentOS 7 image is here and ready for us to use. So we'll click on Create a New Virtual Machine. You can use a physical device when you're building a virtual machine. You can choose whatever the device you want it to be. It depends on the options that you will get. You can use an ISO image, which is what we will be doing, or you can choose to install the operating system later. So you can basically create a blank virtual machine. If, for example, it's a client that you're building with Kickstart, you would do something like that. So we will use the ISO image. We'll click on Browse, go to Downloads, select our CentOS image and click Open. So that will say CentOS 7 64-bit detected, and that's what we're expecting to see. And then we can click Next. It is Linux, so now we are here in the Lapsed. We click Next and we go to this bit here. This is very important to us in the course because we need to make sure that we name this correctly. If we don't name this correctly and we just click Next on this, the virtual machine name will be CentOS 7 64-bit. It will have spaces in it. So all of the files that get created in the root VMware folder will have spaces in them. and there's a network custom networking script that we'll need to use later on that will not work if there are spaces in the name. So if you skip this part, if you miss it, you will reach a point that you'll have to delete your virtual machine and rebuild it because you skipped this part. So make sure that you name this Vim Prometheus 0. This is the name of your first virtual machine. Click Next. Let's go for 10 gigabytes of hard drive space. We're not going to really use the hard drive space on this much. We just need to have enough to build the operating system on it. Click Next. And then here we get a listing of what our virtual machine will look like in its characteristics. We can go and customize hardware here. So my computer has 24 gigabytes of RAM. So I've given my Prometheus VM 16 gigabytes of RAM. So I have plenty of memory to play around with. So I can give it some more. It will run with 1 gigabyte of memory. So if your computer has 8 and your Prometheus VM is using 4, then leave it at 1. However, it will be a bit slower. Of course, if I can spare the memory, I will. So I'm changing the memory to 2 gigabytes. Processor cores will stay at 1. We have our DVD drive, which is the ISO image that we're using. The networking for this virtual machine is in NAT, and I will explain later on what this means. There's a sound card, a printer, USB controller, and display. We don't really care about this that much. So we close this, and we go and click Finish. There's a lot of information here, so basically it's a recap of what happened. You need to install the guest operating system, and then you can install VMware tools. So when you go through the steps here, it will ask you about VMware tools and what they are and so on. I recommend that you click on this so that you see exactly what the VMware tools are, and there is a question later on about the functionality of VMware tools. So I usually tick on boxes like that because it's more efficient so that messages don't pop up every time. Click close, and now the virtual machine will start running on its own. So we click finished, we'll get a message about installing VMware tools, select download and install. So now when the virtual machine starts booting up, we should get the VMware tools message. So following software is available, do it, download and install. What is it? VMware Tools is useful because it allows you to use the virtual machine much easier. It lets you move the mouse around and so on inside and out the virtual machine. It lets you drag and drop items to copy and paste them. So it's generally a good idea to have it. So we can hide that, get it out of the way. We can click inside, and now we are located inside the virtual machine. If we use the up and down arrows, we can go through the different options here. We want to install CentOS 7. Click Enter. So now when I'm moving my mouse is essentially trapped inside the virtual machine. I'm going to click Enter again to start the installation process. Oh, and now I really lost my mouse. All right, here we go. Okay, so the virtual machine will start up and the installation is underway. So we are now here. It is of course a good thing to keep track of what's happening in the Labsit, and of course you should be taking screenshots of almost every step or write down the configuration changes of every step if it's not too important. So that you document it in your logbook. You just need to decide exactly what you want to take a screenshot of or just write down what you did. So we can get this out of the way. We don't need it anymore. Okay, so for example, in this stage, we're choosing the language United Kingdom. You don't actually need to take a screenshot of this. It's pretty simple, pretty basic. All right, so just write in your logbooks, language was chosen to English United Kingdom, and click Continue. If you are working from home, you are working on a computer that you've brought from abroad, from your home country, if you are an overseas student, then you need to make sure that whatever keyboard layout you select here is the keyboard layout that works best for your computer. Okay, so if it's an Indian computer or if it's anything like that, you need to choose the correct layout so that all of the characters display correctly and you can type everything correctly, all the forward and backward slashes and everything else. All right, so my laptop is a UK laptop. I just click continue. And now here we have the different areas of the installation of how we can actually customize the installation of the operating system. So we have software selection, installation destination, and network and host name that we need to make changes to. So software selection is this one, and we need to configure it to GNOME Desktop. If you skip this step, the default is minimal install, so that will basically create a terminal-only installation. Let me check something. So we change it from minimal install to GNOME Desktop. There are different versions of the operating system that you can install with different functionality. What we want, what covers what we'll be doing here, is GNOME Desktop. So click on Done. Next step is installation destination. So this is where essentially we will format the hard drive. What it does at this stage is checking the software dependencies. So according to the installation version that we chose, it will now choose all the packets that need to be installed and how much the installation space needs to be and so on. So we can go on to installation destination. You should see only one hard drive, that's 10 gigabytes, and you should leave it to automatically configure partitioning. Just click done, just double check that everything is like that in there. And the third step is network and host name. All we need to do here is go and change the name of the virtual machine to vprometheus0.netlab.ee.port.ac.uk. So this is the fully qualified domain name, so the full name of the virtual machine. Click done. There are other sections in here as well, but they're not really that important. So you have date and time, you have the keyboard layout, language, you have the installation source, which is the local media, which in our case it's the ISO image, which if we go to the virtual machine settings down here, we can see that it's actually the ISO that we downloaded. We have KDAMP that is used for diagnostics and so on. We don't really need to do anything about it. And we have the security policy, firewall settings and so on that we don't need. We can leave them at default as they are at the moment. Click on begin installation. There's a progress bar, it will go to the end. While it's doing that, you can set the root password. Root password is localhost 1. Type it again, localhost 1. It will tell you that it's weak. It will tell you that the password fails the dictionary check. And if you click done once, nothing happens. Press done again to use it anyway. So twice to verify with them, with the operating system, that you know that your password is weak, but you want to use it anyway. Click on user creation. So full name of the user, it can be anything. And just type VAS. Username, I will say, set it to do not use me. All right, require a password. Let's set it to localhost 1 again. And click done twice again. And now we just wait for the installation to be finished. So you can see it's saying installing packet 41 out of 1,407. So this will take a while. So let me skip ahead. Okay, so the installation is finished. We get a button here that says reboot, so just click on it and the virtual machine should restart. So there are two kernels to choose from, so leave it at default to the first one. And we should eventually get the login screen, maybe? Okay, good. So license information. So you need to accept. Click done. And we've done the network and host name. Finish configuration. It will reboot one last time. And give us the login screen. So once you're here, you click on not listed. So let me move this so that we can see the lab sheet a little bit as well. So we're here, installation, do everything and so on. So now we're logging into our virtual machine. We click on not listed. Our type of username is root. And our password is localhost1 and enter. It will give us our desktop environment. Okay, so now we're here, complete the user post setup. So you go away, click next, 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 skip, start using, and close the window. And what we need to do is we need to make sure that it has internet access. So if you go here to the speaker and click on it, you get a quick shortcut to the settings of the virtual machine's operating system. Click on the wired off, wired settings. And what we'd like to do is go into the little cog here and connect automatically. So this will start up the network card every time we start the computer automatically. Close this. If we open a terminal, we can see that our name is vprometheus0, so that was set up correctly. And if we type ifconfig, we can see the IP address that our network card has taken. So our network card is ANS33, and it has this IP address. And we should be able to ping google.com. All right, so that's done, and it's working because we're getting a ping response back from Google. So now we've done all the way down to the end of this particular section. Okay. VMware and virtual machine settings. So what are we dealing with here? So we need to familiarize ourselves a little bit with VMware and what sort of changes, if not, we can make to our virtual machine settings. So now that we have a working virtual machine, let's see what information we can change. Is it every bit as real or function as a real actual computer? So go to virtual machine settings and see what we have there. So virtual machine, as I said, that menu will now work. So we can go here, we can see that it's similar to what we had before. So we have various different settings that we can change here. So if we go, for example, to power, we can see reset, suspend, power off. So I want you to try them and I want you to see exactly what happens with them, how they affect the running of the virtual machine. And then what can you do with removable devices in a virtual machine? So we have these devices here. If we click cancel, go to machine, removable devices, what can you do? So for example, you can connect to the ISO image, or you can remove an adapter, disconnect it, or you can change the way that it connects and so on. So I want you to write a quick paragraph explaining what you can actually do with the removable devices here. So make sure that VP0 or vPrometheus0 is powered off, and let's go to virtual machine settings. So you can either power it off from here, going here like this, or the quick and easy way for me is init 0, initialize run level 0, which basically shuts it down. So go back to system tools, VMware player. Now it's asking to look at specific VM settings. It's asking to change the memory from 4 to 1 gigabytes. So you can do that and figure out what happens to the virtual machine. So if we click on it, we can now go edit virtual machine settings. So we can change the memory. We can change the number of processor cores. Okay, so I want you to play around and try and see exactly what happens. You have the visualization engines. I want you to do your research on them and write a couple of lines about what each of these options actually does. Okay, so interestingly enough, as an example, if we go to our Prometheus home machine and we go into the settings of that, go to processors, we'll see that the option for virtualize Intel VTX is actually enabled, and it has to be for what we're doing. So why is it enabled here and not here? Change the number, of course, reset the visualization engines, and so on. And then I need you to know where the virtual machines actually live. So if we cancel the settings of this, minimize this, home folder, and then we can go into VMware, vPrometheus 0, and we have our files here. So what do they actually do? What are these files here? I want you to know what the VMX file does and what the VMDK files do, and so on. So you need to do a little bit of research in that. Okay, so what is the total size of this? So if we change the view on this, we can click on detail, we can see the size of all of the files here. So it's about 4 gigabytes at the moment. All right, go to the virtual machine settings, click on hard disk and expand the hard drive to 30 gigabytes. So go here, here, hard drive, change it. You can expand it, you can compact it, and so on. Do that. You'll see that current size is 4.5 gigabytes, which reflects the contents of this folder here. And the maximum size that it can expand to is 10 gigabytes. And I have 55 gigabytes free on the system available to use. So those 55 gigabytes are free on my Prometheus home virtual machine. Okay. So play around with this and see what actually happens with the size of the files and the virtual machine. Let's go on now to the more important aspect of this, networking, VMware default networking. VP0 is currently connecting to the outside world using a NAT configuration. I want you to start up your virtual machine and write down its IP address, default gateway, and DNS server. How did these addresses come about? What is the mechanism for the virtual machines to get allocated those IP addresses? So now, let's test the rest of the network options, and in order to do that, we need to have 3 more of those VMs. You don't have to rebuild everything again. You can basically just clone the virtual machine. So if we go into our VMware folder, we can click on Prometheus, copy, paste. Make sure that you wait for this progress pie to be completed before you do anything else. You'll come up with this method saying duplicated 10 files and so on. So we can paste again, and that's going to be called another copy. And then we get our progress here. And again, you need to wait for this to finish before you do anything. And then finally, we do it once more, and that will give us the 4 virtual machines that we'll need in order to work with. So, the copy, we can rename it, and this will be vPrometheus 1. In fact, let's see. I copied it. Yep, that's correct. Rename, and then another copy is going to be renamed to vPrometheus 2. And the third copy will be renamed to vPrometheus 3. So the folder names have changed, but the file names inside there have not. They will all be 0 always, and that's fine. We don't need to rename the files inside there. Okay, so rename the folder, go terminal, type VM player, and so on. So now what we need to do is we need to start VMware player again. And I can now open a virtual machine. So I have my folders, I click on one, I click on the VMX file. So the one that's selected here I edit its virtual machine settings, I go to Options, and I verify that it is in fact vPrometheus 1. Alright, so I'm going to rename this according to what's on the lab sheet here to VP1 bridged. Okay, so I will do this and I will basically go into the network adapter options and I will set this to bridged. Click save. I will power on. You need to say that you copied the virtual machine so that it creates a new unique virtual machine ID and it will start it up. Remember, this is the same virtual machine that we copied the files. So essentially, it's the same virtual machine that we created before. So it will still be called vPrometheus 0. So we'll need to change it. So we log in, root, localhost 1, sign in. And what we need to do, open a terminal, it's called vPrometheus 0, so we need to change it. So we will vi, etc., host name. Enter, press the insert button, change the 0 into 1, press the escape button, then press the colon, W, Q, enter. Reboot. Will rename this virtual machine to vPrometheus 1. So this process will need to be repeated for all of the other virtual machines, VP2 and VP3. So we've copied them, we'll need to rename them in the virtual machine settings, we'll need to change the connection type in the network card, and we need to go inside and basically rename the virtual machine itself as well. Okay, so click on not listed. Root localhost 1, enter. So now let's talk a little bit about the networking side of things. So the first virtual machine was in NAT, that's network address translation. So this is essentially what all of your home routers are doing in order to give you IP addresses for your computers in your home network. You get a public IP address and it's translated onto a private network with private IP addresses, class C or whatever they are, and they get allocated to everything that's connected to them. With the same principle, virtual machine 0, which is in NAT mode, will get allocated the private IP address from the nothing process that's running on Prometheus itself. If we go to our terminal, let's make it full screen. If we type ifconfig, we can see that we have our network card, that's 192.168.38.133. And then we have VMnet 1 and VMnet 8. VMnet 8 is the network card that works for nothing for VMware itself, and that has an address of 192.168.226.1. So a different private network to the one that our physical, for all intents and purposes, network card actually has. So when Virtual Machine 0 starts, it gets allocated an IP address that's on this network here. So it will have a 26.226.2 or .128 or whatever it is. It gets that IP address. By the VMnet 8 NAT DHCP server that's running for this VMnet 8 network card. So it is actually this process down here. So there's a DHCP server running for VMnet 8 that is started by VMware, exactly like there is one for VMnet 1, which is the one that's used for our host-only networking in VMware to give addresses to virtual machines and so on. There is no DHCP server for the bridge. The bridge just runs as a process there. So what we need to do is we need to look at our IP address here, and we need to allocate an IP address in our virtual machine 1 that is on the same network. So a NATed network will have its own private IP address translation, so it will do its own thing. Whereas a bridge network, such as VP1, we will be working on the same subnet as the host. So we'll need to go on to our wired connected settings, wired settings, click on the cog again, and click on IPv4 and set the IP addresses manual. All right, so now we're going to use 192.168.38.134, for example. Okay, since 133 is here, we'll have to use another one. Subnet mask is the same as it is here, so 255.255.255.0, and our gateway is whatever the gateway will be for ENS33. Lots of ways to find this. We can go to the graphical mode, we can click on this, wired settings. So these are now the network card settings of Prometheus itself. Okay, and we can see that the default gateway is 38.2. So we close that, and 38.134.38.2. So 192.168.38.2. All right, we'll also need to know the DNS server. It will be the same. So 192.168.38.2. Click Apply, restart the network card, close this, open the terminal. Ifconfig should now give me an IP address of 38.134, and I can ping google.com from my VP1 bridged virtual machine. To really understand what's happening here, we have 192.168.38.134, which is on the same network as 192.168.38.133. This is the IP address on Prometheus. So VP1 and Prometheus are on the same network. So there is a bridge formed between Virtual Prometheus 1 and Prometheus. However, if we get out into my Windows machine and look at my network card settings, where is it? Here, network and internet settings, go to my Ethernet and change adapter options. We look at the network cards that my Windows host is actually running, and we can see that I have VMnet 8 and VMnet 1 again in Windows. It's VMware Player on my host, so it's the same scenario. If we look here, look at the details. We have a win server of 192.168.38.2, and this VMnet 8 network card has an IP address of 169.254.60.211. So for all intents and purposes, this is the external public IP address for my virtual machine that it connects to, and this is the internal network that my Prometheus host virtual machine is getting internet access through. All right, and that is what's powering up, what's giving network access on this. So if you want to go all the way, you're going from network 38 through network 38 on Prometheus home, through the 169 or whatever it was onto my host, which is a virtual network, which then goes onto my another 192.168.1.5 or whatever the IP address of my laptop is in my network, to the 192.168.1.1, which is the my home internet router's DNS/gateway, to the public IP address that I have on the hyperoptic network that goes out to the internet. So at this point, we're going through 1, 2, 3, 4 different networks until we reach the internet outside my house. Okay, and this is the simplest version because this is bridged. Virtual machine 0, which is NATed, goes through 5 different levels of network address translation. All right, cool stuff. So that's virtual machine 1. Let's play around with virtual machine 2. So I will shut this down because I don't need it and I don't want to be running multiple virtual machines at the same time. I don't want to put a stress on my system. There's really no reason for it. System tools, VMware player. And we'll start up vPrometheus 2. Before I do that, I will take the opportunity to rename my virtual machine 0 to VP0 NAT as well. So, settings, and go to options, so that is VP0 NAT. Okay, VP0 NAT, VP1 bridged, and I'm going to file, open another virtual machine, which will be 2, and I'm going to go into its settings, and I'm going to rename it to VP2. Host only. Save it, and I will go into the network card settings and I will change it to host only. So bridged, not host only. Host only creates another private network through VMnet1, which is isolated from the rest of the world. So that will create a sort of private network inside between this virtual machine and my Prometheus host so that I can work in a more isolated environment. Again, we need to choose I copied it. So it is the same principle of operation as NAT, but it won't give it a private IP address. It can have whatever IP address you like, so you can make it a public IP address if you like. I'm not listed, root, localhost 1. open a terminal, and we'll need to rename this, of course, vi, etc. Hostname, insert, change this to 2, escape, colon, right quit, and reboot. So that's renamed as well. Now we're at this part where we set up the host only VM. Oh, okay. Root local host 1. Okay. So open a terminal. So now the networking at this point is what? We have changed the network card into host only. So let's see what we have. Ifconfig. Yes, so the IP address has changed into another network, 172.16.182. Why? If we go back into our ifconfig in our host, we'll see that vmnet1, which is responsible for a host only operation, is on 172.16.182.1. Okay, so same network, different IP address. And will we have internet access? Ping google.com. No. And this is to be expected because host only creates a host only network, which is isolated from the rest of the world. Right. So that's that. And we can shut this down and go and play around with the last virtual machine. So we've seen that there are three different network card settings that our virtual machines provide us: bridge, NAT, and host only. However, we need to have a custom network card because we want to be able to customize our network exactly to our needs, give full internet access, even if it's on a host-only basis, and so on. So we have a script that's called vm_subnet2 that we've been using for going on about 20 years maybe now. I think I used something like it when I was a student as well. And we use it to create, to alter basically, the settings of the virtual machine. So if we open virtual machine 3, and go to its settings, we can set the name first of all. So that's going to be called, what do I call it? Let's see, VP3 custom. So that's VP3 custom. And we want to have a custom network card option here, which we don't at the moment. So click save, close this, and let's go and figure out what's happening with those scripts. So we need to have a script called vm_subnet2, and then we need to have another script called fix_vmnet_dev. So if we go on to Moodle, the files are here and we can download them. If you simply click on them and the other one, they will be downloaded into our downloads folder. Okay. So we have fix_vmnet_dev and vm_subnet_2. So what is it that we actually do here? We want to create a custom network. We want that network to be based on the IP addresses that we want to be using for our computers. So let's make it an interesting scenario. Let's say that we have the lab. Okay, so let's say that we have A2.NET and we have a bunch of computers in the lab. We basically have 24 computers on the left side of the desks in the lab. We want to make sure that we allocate IP addresses to all of the computers in the lab and all of their virtual machines without having any IP address conflicts. So what we've done is we've taken a class C subnet that starts at 148.197.30.0 and ends at 148.197.30.255, and we've split it into 32 slices. We only have 24 computers that we need. However, the slices that you split a network into must be powers of 2. Okay, so we couldn't split it to 24 slices. We had to split it into 32 slices because that's the closest power of 2 that has enough spaces for the networks that we want to have. All right, because you can have 0, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. So we couldn't have 16 networks, they were not enough. So we have 32 networks, which gives us the 24 that we need with 8 networks to spare. This has the result that each of those little subnets that we have created for each of our computers is its own network space. So the characteristics of each of the network space is that they have a network address, they have a broadcast address, and they have usable IP addresses for the network cards in that network. So let's say, for example, that I'm working on the very last line of this. Okay, on the very last line of our allocation. So I'm going to be using one of my spare addresses because my computer is not in those 24 computers that we have in the lab. All right, so I will choose to work with line 32. So the first thing that you need to choose to do is choose one of our Formula One champions and work for them. Okay, so if you decide to work with Mansell, then your network address is 48, your broadcast address is 55, and usable IP addresses are everything in between. We will be building a small custom network that will need to have two network cards. The first network card will be the VMnet2 network card that will be running on our host. So we have VMnet 1, we have VMnet 8. We will make a VMnet 2 network card appear here, and its address will be an IP address from in here. And then we will start up our virtual machine 3, and we'll give it another IP address in this same custom network space, which will be another one of these IP addresses available here. So let's work on my example on the last line here. Network of 248, broadcast of 255, and usable IP addresses of everything in between. What do I need to do? I need to edit my VM subnet file. So I will open it with the text editor, I'll make it full screen, and I will look at what I have here. Everything has comments and explanations of what everything does. You don't need to worry about it too much. What you do need to worry about is the IP addresses that you need to have here. So my network card is going to be called VMnet2. My VMnet IP address, so the IP address that will show up on VMnet2, will be 148.197.30.249. Why is that? Because if I look back into my subnet file, my first usable IP address is 30.249. Remember, this is my network address. It declares the beginning of my network. And this is my broadcast address, which is the end of my network space. All right, so I cannot use these as addresses for my network card. 249 is the first usable IP address for me, so that's what will go on the script in this space. Of course, in a similar fashion, if you chose to work with Mansell, then your first IP address would be 49. So that's what you should have there. All right, go back to the script. We have a network address of 248 and a broadcast address of 255. That's again because network address, broadcast address. The only other thing that needs explaining really is our subnet mask. Our subnet mask has changed, and instead of 0, it is now 248. The reason for this is hiding down here. So, let's take a subnet mask of 255, 255, 255, 248. This is in decimal for us mere mortals to understand and use. Computers use binary, specifically 8-bit long binary versions of the addresses. So what is 255 here? It is essentially 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 8 plus 16 plus 32 plus 64 plus 128. So if you add all of this up, it gives us 255. Now, what have we done in our network? We've taken a class C network that was going from 0 to 255, and we split it into 32 slices. Okay, so because we split it into 32 slices, each of the slices has a length of 8. Okay, so number of IPs, 8. 248, 249, 250, 251, 252, 233, 254, 255. 8 addresses. How many digits in binary, how many bits do I need in binary to accommodate 8 addresses? I only need 3 bits. I only need those 3. Okay, because 000, 001, 010, 011, 100, 110, 101, and 111. Okay, this means that only the last 3 of the digits of the subnet mask are now used for our host part of our address, whereas the other 5 can be turned into ones instead of zeros. So if we were working on a default class C subnet mask of 255, 255, 255, 0, this would be 8 ones, 8 ones, 8 ones, and 8 zeros. But because we're not anymore, we're working on a smaller network, then out of the 3 digits that we need for our hosts, the other 5 digits get turned into 1 to become our subnet part of the subnet mask. If you add these up, 128 plus 64 plus 32 plus 16 plus 8 gives us 248, and this is what goes as our subnet mask everywhere in our network configuration. Okay, so this is what the script should look for me. I can save it, close it, I will minimize the browser, and I will move my script and I will stick it in my home folder. All right, I will open a terminal here. And in fact, I can make this a bit bigger. So if I type ifconfig, I now have VMnet 1 and VMnet 8. If I type ls, then my VM subnet 2 script is there, but it's black, it's not executable. I need to make it green. So chmod 777. VM subnet 2 ls, it's green, I can run it. VM subnet 2. For this to happen, remember that your VMware player must be completely shut down. All right, so it's run, it's done its thing. If I type ifconfig now, surprise, surprise, I have a new network card, VMnet 2. I still have VMnet 1 and VMnet 8. But I now have a VMnet 2 network card, which is mine. I've created it with exactly the IP address that I want to have for this. All right, part 1 of my customized network is complete. Part 2 is to have the custom network enabled for the virtual machine itself. And that's where the second script comes into play. The fixVMnet dev script, if I open it up, essentially, what it will do is it will take all of the network cards of the virtual machine and it will create 3 customized network cards. So at the moment, vPrometheus 3 has 1 network card that's NATed. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my fixVMnet file and I'm going to copy and paste it inside my vPrometheus 3 folder. So this script needs to be in the same location as my VMX file. If I open with other application, okay, view all applications, give me an editor, text editor. I can actually see what's inside my VMX file. Okay, and we have sound, power, PCI bridge, processor information, hard drive information, Ethernet connection. All right. So essentially what my custom script will do is it will take the networking information from this file and convert it into something else. Open our terminal in here. ls. Again, we need to make the script executable, so chmod 777 fix, and then .slash fix run. So it's done its thing, it's created Ethernet 0, 1, and 2. So if I exit this, I can go into Applications, System Tools, VMware Player. And check out what's happening with my Virtual Machine 3. VP3 Custom, Edit Settings, 1, 2, 3 network cards with a new menu that has now appeared here, and it's custom. And you can choose where you want it to connect to. I only need one network card for this, so I'm going to remove the second and third. I'm going to go on my first network card and I'm going to connect it onto the VMnet 2 interface that I've just created, and is, come on, this one. All right. So, save this, power on. You must say I copied it. And let it start up. Let's tidy up a little bit. Okay, so now we've done this part, and now we're doing the second paragraph. So we've run the fix VMnet dev, we have the devices and everything. So what happens now? We need to go in, rename it, and then give it the correct IP address so that it can communicate with the host. Login as root. We can already see that the network is not connected here, it's struggling because we changed the network card settings. Open our terminal, connection failed, yes, that's great, to be expected. So VI, etc., host name. Insert, this is 3, escape, colon, right, quit, reboot. So now we can go on to the network card settings. It is a custom network card, as we can see in the settings here of the virtual machine connected to Dev VMnet 2. So we go into our little cog, go to IPv4, set to manual, and my IP address will be 148.197.30.250. The reason why is because my VMnet 2 is 148.197.30.249, which is within the range of the addresses that belong to me, 3249 to 3254. Okay, so that my subnet mask is going to be 255.255.255.248, and my gateway is going to be 148.197.30.249, which is the IP address for the VMnet 2 network card. All right, DNS server, it doesn't really matter because I'm not going to get there anyway. If I really do want to make it work, I would use something like the DNS server that Prometheus has. So if I go to wired settings, I sort of remember it was 38.2. So I can set my DNS server as 192.168.38.2. Click apply, off, on, and open my terminal. ifconfig, and now my IP address is 30.50. Can I ping google.com? Of course not, because I cannot reach my DNS server, because I cannot go further than my host, because I'm on network 30 and my host is on network 192.168.38. And to cross between different networks for computers, you need to have routing in place. Can I at least ping my default gateway? 148.197.30.249. I can. So my connection works correctly. I just need the routing to be able to get to the outside world from Virtual Machine 3. And that is the last part of the Lapsit. So to give internet access to Virtual Machine 3, you need to set up routing on the host. To do this, you need to install Quagga and configure OSPF as the protocol for it. At the end of this task, you should be able to successfully ping google.com from Virtual Machine 3. So I will not help you with this. So this will be the task that you'll need to do your own research. So you need to turn your Prometheus host into a router. So everything that you do for this part of the Lapsit will happen on the Prometheus host itself. Okay, you need to install Quagga, which is the routing daemon for Linux, and you need to configure the OSPF routing protocol on it. You need to make everything run, and once it works, you should be able to have internet access from the Prometheus 3. Okay, so this is the Lapsit. Essentially, quite a lot of work to do, but it's worth it because you learn pretty much everything that you can do with VMware, and most importantly, how the networking works, which is essentially the most important aspect of it, really, in order to build multiple networks of virtual machines and go into something like a cloud environment later on. All right. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, feel free to come into my drop-in sessions and find me on Discord as well.